spend all the better part of their life on the pleasures of this world before retiring to the church, before it is too late for them to get hooked on one naive Christian brother in search of a Christian wife to marry. No sooner she's married, she takes control of the man's life and finances. And this is why Apostle Paul advised Christians, if you are married, stay married. Amen. If you are single like him, remain single. Amen. But if you cannot hold it, then look for a damsel and marry. But not to marry a pagan, an unbeliever Christian, or else you will have another Satan in the house to condemn you. Praise God.
Amen.
And the next one is weariness.
Oh my God.
Especially. Those in future are easy to pass off through small, small illnesses, such as back pain, such as headache, such as tiredness. And this is not to say that all back pain or headache or tiredness are spiritual attack. We need to discern carefully what is what. You are an usher or a notable member of the choir. You have been watching your favorite video, and when it is just 20 minutes to start getting ready for church, that you start running stomach, or feeling dizzy with headache, or you start coughing. And when you are asked to come out, Satan has already provided you with an alibi. My throat is haunting me. I'm just having this same cough. I don't be able to sing. You go ahead or pray for me. You are joking. If the whole church pray for you, God will not answer it. But God cannot be mocked. I have few witnesses in this church. It is when the time to leave for the church that they will remember they need a ride. 10 minutes to get ready for the church, they remember they need a ride. God will not send down Elijah, chariot of fire, to carry you to the church. Since you know how you find your way to the church, to your own place of work every week. So if you don't come to the church, we don't miss you. You miss your own blessing. And I'm sorry about that. Second one is, sit down.
Amen.
Then Satan often uses darkness.
Richard.
Satan often uses darkness. Nightmares. Insomnia. And other night-related concerns. How many of us have been tormented or victimized in sleep by agents of Satan, by demons, by witches, by wizards, warning us or trying to dissuade us from rescuing fellow Christian brothers or sisters from their bondage? They will even have the audacity to tell you, don't you know that we are the one responsible for her sickness, or her loss of job, or frustrating his destiny, or good fortune of his children? If you too are not adequately spiritually prepared for spiritual warfare, how will you be able to help your children? How will you be able to help your friends? How will you be able to help your Christian brothers and sisters? How many here are not afraid of the dark? But if you have your trust in Jesus, there will be nothing to fear except fear itself,
amen,
which our Lord and Savior has conquered for us. King David had great faith in God, as he expressed in Psalm 23:4. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
Amen.
Then we have four defenses. Four defenses. Before moving into the four defenses that God has given to us, let us first note an important fact. Our defenses must be in place all the time. Our defenses must be in place all the time. An army who waits until they are under attack to take up a defensive position is likely to have insufficient time to fully take up their position. The advantage of surprise attack has been proved many times throughout military history. It is so for spiritual attack, and our defenses need to be in place at all times.
Amen.
No time for relaxation at all if you are a Christian.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
History has also shown us on many occasions that a small defensive force can withstand attack from a much larger number if it has strong defenses. Consider Nehemiah, who positioned half of his men as guards while the walls of Jerusalem were being built. They were ready and prepared to ward off such attack. So strong were their defenses that the enemy could not attack, as we read in Nehemiah 4, verse 16. The means of defense that God has provided us with are more than enough. One, knowing that we are in Christ.
Amen.
That's number one.
Hallelujah.
Knowing that we are in Christ.
Amen.
Our defense is in knowing that as Christians we are fully covered by the protection offered by our Lord. Here are some scriptures which tell us where we stand as Christians. Psalm 91. Now, Psalm 18, 2 said, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress, and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my heart tower." And then in 1 John 4, 4, he said, "Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." Amen. And then in Colossians 1-4, "If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ seated on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth, for ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye appear also with him in glory." The amazing thing about coming to faith is that God places us by his sovereign power in Jesus. Lansambert writes, "That is your position if you are a child of God. Your position in the sight of God is in Christ. He is not a child of God who is not in Christ. For to be a Christian is to be in Christ, and Christ to be in you."
Amen.
Amen. It is not enough to read it. It's not even enough to believe it when we read it. We must believe it fully with our lives, that we can enter into confidence that we are in Christ. Satan's strategy is to convince, to coin us into believing that this is not true, to allow us to become uncovered. Yet at times, we allow ourselves to become uncovered. Sin can remove us from God's protection, especially deliberate and repetitive sin. The first step is to know that we have cut ourselves out from under that protection through our doubts and unbelief. When you start having doubts, when you start having unbelief, you are gradually getting out of control from God through sin or through a lack of trust in God. From there, it is simple, although not easy, to confessing our weakness, our doubt, and sin, and allowing God's mercy and grace to cover us again.
Amen.
And then the second one is the armor of God.
Amen.
Ephesians 6, 11 to 18 said, it's a classic passage on the armor that God provides. Note what the apostle said in verse 11 and 12, "Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." For many years, I know that the armor of God existed, but I did not know how to put it on. I have had to learn how, for example, to buckle on the belt of truth, or what it means to use the shield of faith. Sometimes we can leave part of the whole armor off, but soldiers in partial armor that are not fully covered may find it easier to move, but are leaving themselves partially uncovered and are an easy target for enemy archers. The giant Goliath had a steel shield and a javelin and a breastplate of metal, but he never ever thought that the only one round stone to his forehead will be the cause of his death, which he exposed for young David to aim his sling, and God brought him down, as God will bring down all the Goliaths in your lives, all the people hearing me this morning, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We need to learn to put on the whole armor. We need to learn to use the shield of faith, bringing it between ourselves and the fiery darts of the devil. And we need to learn to use the sword of the Spirit.
Amen.
This is true for both individual Christians and for the church. Reading this passage in the context of the whole letter to the Ephesians, we see it as a total component of Paul's teachings on living out the gospel as a community of faith. He addresses the corporate church rather than a single Christian or single Christian scout on a mission of spiritual warfare against demons. Lone soldiers make easy targets. Any soldier that walks alone is an easy target for the enemy. And so that's why they say that unity is strength. We must unite, since their lies are our strength to survive. A house divided cannot stand. There should be no competition. There should be no unnecessary suspicions.
Amen.
There should be no unhealthy harassment or attack on our leaders. Let all of us be careful.
Amen.
Let all of us stop making ourselves instrument of judgment against our brothers and sisters, and against especially our leaders.
Yes. Jesus.
And the third consideration is praise and worship.
Amen.
Praise and worship.
Amen.
Psalm 149 describes the praise of God as a double-edged sword. Let them praise his name in the dance. Let them sing praises unto him with the trembling heart. For the Lord taketh pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high priest of God be in their mouth, and a two-edged sword in their hands, to execute vengeance upon the hidden and punishment upon the people. Singing God's praise was a powerful weapon for Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, as we read in Chronicles 20, 21, and 22. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. And when they began to sing and to praise the Lord set ambush against the children of Ammon, against the Moab, against Mount Seir, which we have come against Judah, and they were smitten. Just as praise helped Jehoshaphat to defeat the army of Edom, Moab, and Ammon, so praise is important in our resistance to the attack of Satan. Praise creates an environment which the devil cannot tolerate. He cannot tolerate it for three reasons. One, praise proclaims the name of the Lord Jesus. Two, praise is the result of the Holy Spirit working in us. As we read in Hebrews 13:15, by him therefore, let us offer the sacrifices of praise to God continually, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name.
Hallelujah.
And then God, the third one, God inhabits our praise.
Hallelujah.
As read in Psalm 22, 3 and 4, but thou art holy.
Hallelujah.
O thou that inhabit the praises of Israel, our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted, and thou didst deliver them.
Amen.
And then number 4, and like the Kenneth Lima used to say, praises go up, blessings come down.
Amen.
You cannot praise him with all your might without being blessed by him.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Amen.
Do not underestimate the power of praise and worship. to help us in difficult situations. In Acts of Apostles, we read of Paul and Silas locked in prison. Instead of being downcast at their suffering and predicament, they started praising and worshiping God. Their praise unlocked the power of God and secured their release. In Acts 16, 25 to 26, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaking, and immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's pants were loose.
Amen.
Playing praise and worship tapes or CD, when we feel under attack, grace and atmosphere of praise around us. This not only adds to our defenses, but also can help the Spirit minister to us in times of need.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And this is the reason. This is the reason. Why we in this church are so concerned about the quality and performances of our praise and worship and choir in the church. Be